Hello friends, welcome to Expert Guidance. Today in this video, we'll be covering the last topic of structure and function in living organism unit, which is coordination and response. Now this is a very important topic. Now in this video, we'll be covering the topic how organisms are able to respond to changes in the environment. We'll come to very important concept of homeostasis. What is homeostasis? How animals maintain homeostasis? Then we'll come in the flowering plant, how plant responds to stimuli, the geotropic and phototropic movement and responses in plants. We'll also cover the concept of plant hormones. Then we'll come to the difference between the nervous and hormonal communication in humans or animals. We'll come to the role of central nervous system, peripheral nervous system, reflex action, and we'll also look over the structure of the eye and the brain as well. And we'll also see how the different hormones are coordinated by the activity of the brain. Now, this is a very important topic of control, coordination, and homeostasis. A lot of conceptual questions are asked from this topic. Now, I would recommend you to watch this video till the end, because in the end, we'll be looking over the key definitions and some exam style questions as well on this topic. So, let's begin. Now, what exactly is homeostasis and why is it important? Now, homeostasis is the process of maintaining the constant internal environment. Now, the question is, what is constant internal environment? Constant internal environment is maintaining a constant temperature, pH, blood glucose, and salt and water level. Now, when we maintain a constant temperature, that is known as thermoregulation. Maintaining salt and water level is osmoregulation. So, maintaining all these factors is what is homeostasis. Now, how this homeostasis is achieved? This is achieved by two systems working in your body, the nervous system and the hormonal system. Now, why this constant internal environment is important? This constant internal environment or homeostasis is important for the enzymes, as it is the enzymes which are controlling all the reactions and metabolism of the body, and they need optimum conditions to work. If the temperature increases or the pH level increases, it can change the activity of the enzyme and it can affect your body reaction. So it is very important to maintain the homeostasis. Now, whether it is a nervous system or the hormonal system, how it works, it's the whole hierarchy how it works. Like in an organization, we have different levels. Like we have the lower levels and then the people at the higher level and then the people at the management level. In the same way, the nervous system is very coordinated activity of the body. Now, how it works, this flowchart is very important. First of all, there's a stimulus. What is a stimulus? Stimulus is any change in the external or the internal condition that makes your body to take any action or produce a response. For example, suddenly the temperature increases. So what you'll do, you will wear lighter clothes, you will switch on the fan. So you take some action because you want your body temperature to be normal. So first of all, there's always a change. So change could be change in temperature, pH, salt and water level. Now this change is detected by the body. Now who detects this change? These are the receptors. Now the change could be external and the internal. So the external receptors are your sense organs. So for example, there's a change in light intensity, the eye will detect. Change in sound intensity, your ears will detect. Change in temperature, your skin will detect. Or there are internal receptors in the brain, because at times what happens, the outer temperature is normal, but suddenly your body temperature increases. So there are changes in the internal conditions which are detected by the receptors in the brain. Now, when they detect the change, they send the message to the controlling center. The controlling center is the central nervous system, which is composed of brain and the spinal cord, which takes the information from the receptors, processes the information, decides the action, and sends the message to the effectors. What are the effectors? Effectors are the muscles of the gland, because your body, to control, to make the stimulus, to respond to the stimulus, they need to either take any action, that is to move any muscle,
or they need to release a hormone. So the effectors are generally the muscles or the gland, which are directed by the central nervous system to take actions, and then they produce a response. For example, there's a change in blood glucose level. So your brain receptors will detect it, goes to the central nervous system. Central nervous system directs the pancreas to release insulin. Okay, so effectors in this case would be the gland. Now let us look at what are the three types of neurons that we find in the nervous system. The first type is the motor neuron, which takes the impulses away from the CNS, which was here. So motor neurons were sending the message from the central nervous system to the effectors. And if you see this, it has a long dendrite. So if you remember in the cell biology, we did that. It's a special cell. It has a long dendrite that receives impulses, and they transmit it through the long axon. And then at the end, there's a nerve ending. Then there's a sensory neuron, which takes the impulses to the CNS. It takes the message from the receptors to the central nervous system. It has a small cell body and a long axon. And then the dendrite is also extended. And at the end, you have the nerve ending. Then you have the relay neuron, which are found in the CNS. That is, these are the neurons which are found inside the brain and the spinal cord. So they connect the sensory and a motor neuron. So they just have a big cell body, does not have a long axon, as the impulses do not have to travel a long distance, and they have the nerve ending. So you should know the difference between the three types of neurons, where we find them, and what is their function. And if possible, you should know this diagram of the neuron and what are the labelings, what are the each terms, each things which are there in this structure. Next is a reflex action. At times, you must have seen that you touch something hot, you immediately remove your hand, and after you have removed your hand, you realize that you have taken any action. So you take that action, which is automated without even you thinking, because your body receptors has already detected it and found that it's an emergency situation. And what do? They send the message to the spinal cord and not to the brain. So there's a stimulus detected by the receptors. The receptor sends the message via sensory neuron to the spinal cord, remember, not to the brain, and then the effectors and produces a response. So you can see here, it's a spinal cord. It's like a H-shaped structure. And if you touch something sharp or hot, the message goes via receptors, via sensory neuron to the spinal cord. Spinal cord sends the message to the relay neuron. The relay neuron sends it to the motor neuron and to the muscle to remove the hand. So it is the automatic response of the body to a stimulus. In reflex action, the message from the sensory neuron is passed to the spinal cord instead of brain. The spinal cord sends the message to the effectors and produces a response. Example, knee-jerk reflexes, touching hot objects, sudden closure of the light with bright light. The advantages of the reflex action is it is rapid, it is quick, it is automated, instantaneous, without any conscious thought. Okay, so I hope this concept of reflex action, how it works, and the advantages are clear to you. Next we have is a synapse. Now, you know that the message in the neurons is transmitted by electrical impulses. But there comes a point, which is this, which is a junction between the two neurons. And this junction between the two neurons, or the gaps between the two neurons, is the synapse. And here the message is not transmitted electrically. It is transmitted by the chemicals called the neurotransmitters. So what we have is, at the end of one of the neuron, we have the vesicles which contains this neurotransmitter. Whenever the electrical impulses arrives, these vesicles are forced to fuse with the membrane, release the neurotransmitters into the synapse. This neurotransmitters is taken up by the receptors of the other neuron, and it produces electrical impulses on the other neuron. Okay, so you should know what is a synapse and how synapse works, and this diagram is important. Okay, so next we have the biggest controlling center of the body, which is the brain. So in the brain, you should know this is a hypothalamus. Then the main part is the forebrain. And then here you have the midbrain. And then you have the hindbrain, which is your cerebellum. The forebrain is cerebrum. And then you have this stalk, which is your medulla oblongata. Now the cerebrum, which is your forebrain, is responsible for your consciousness, memory, intelligence, and the language. The cerebellum, which is the hindbrain here, which is a round circle. It is responsible for muscle coordination and balance. And this long stalk, which is the medulla oblongata, is responsible for unconscious activities like the heart rate, the breathing rate, and the gut movement. So you should know the labeling of each of these parts along with the function. Now, the brain scan is where we do the magnetic resonance imaging and take the images of the different parts of the brain. And then we find if there's any clot, if there's any thrombosis, if there's any problem there with the brain. And then we relate this problem with the loss of function of the individual. Now, there are a lot of problems with the brain scan because the brain is complex. There's a skull which protects the brain. There are thousands of neurons, thousands of neurotransmitters involved. The function of the different parts is still not known. And due to the presence of skull, it is difficult for the drugs to reach the brain. So the brain damage is the biggest problem, okay? Therefore, people are advised to cover and protect the heads while they are driving to make sure the damage to the brain is protected, okay? Next is the eye. This is the structure of the eye. You should know different labelings and the function of each of them, and it is very important. So the front part you can see here is the cornea. It's like a little bulge outwards, and the function of the cornea is to refract the light so that it can enter the lens properly. Then in front of the eye, you can see this is an iris. This is like a muscle that controls this aperture, which is the pupil. Okay, a pupil is nothing, but it is the aperture which opens and closes depending on the light it enters. If the light is not that bright, the iris will retreat back, increasing the hole so that more light enters. If there's a bright light, then the iris will decrease the size of the pupil. Then you have the lens. The lens function is to focus the light on the retina. Then the lens is attached with the help of the ciliary muscles. It can contract and relax to change the shape of the lens. And there's a suspensory ligaments that's a support the lens onto the ciliary muscles. Then you can see there is a retina. Retina is the place where the image is formed. And then you have the choroid layer, which is the blood vessels that gives all the nutrients required to the eye. And there's a fovea, which is the part of the retina only with the cone cell. And then there is a blind spot. This blind spot is where the optic nerves enters the retina, and this optic nerve sends the message from the retina to the brain so that it can process the information and helps you to see. And then you have the fluid that fills the anterior part, which is the aqueous humor, and the posterior part is filled with the vitreous humor. This is the fluid that fills the eye and helps the eye to withstand pressure. Okay, so I hope all these parts along with this function is clear to you. Now, eyes do different changes so that it can see the far objects and the near objects, and these changes are known as accommodation. So for a distant vision, you can see that the ciliary muscles relax, making the suspensory ligaments tense, which in turn makes the lens thin. So you can see to see the far points, the lens has become thin so that the image is properly focused onto the retina, and the retina then can sense the message to a brain via optic nerve. But when you see the near point, the ciliary muscles, they are contracting, making the suspensory ligament too slack so that the lens become thicker so that the image can properly be focused on the retina. So you should know what changes takes place in the lens for distant vision and the near vision. Now, there are a lot of defects of vision. At times, people can just see the objects which are just at a short distance and cannot see the objects which are at the long distance. So there's a short-sightedness. So there's a short-sightedness and the long-sightedness. So in short-sightedness, which is myopia, the image falls, you can see, in front of the retina so that you cannot see it properly because the eyeball gets elongated. You can see that. So for that, what we do, we use a concave lens which properly refracts the light and make sure it falls on the retina. In hyperopia, you need to remember the image falls behind the retina. So the eyeball gets shortened and it is corrected by a convex lens. So you should know these both defects of vision. Now, there are other new eye technologies that have emerged. Now, we can take contact lenses because it's not always feasible for the sports player or for the models to wear the spectacles spectacles all the time, the concave lenses or convex lenses. So in that case, we put the lenses just on the surface of the eye, which can be soft, self-disposable, and they can be used by any person at any age. Then there's a laser surgery in which we change the thickness or the curve of the cornea so that it can properly refract and make the image at the retina. But it is generally done at the adults because at the growing stage, the people can still have problems, so laser surgery cannot be successful. Then there's a replacement lenses where you either replace the faulty lens or insert the correct one in place of the faulty one. Now, there are some damage risks because it's a surgery, so there are some damage risks to the eye that is involved. Okay, so I hope these all defects of vision and what are the treatments is crystal clear to you. Now, we have seen the hormonal control. Now, let us see the nervous control. So to remind you, we started with this concept of homeostasis, and we saw that homeostasis involves the nervous system and the endocrine system. The nervous system uses a system of the neurons, and the endocrine system involves the endocrine glands, which releases the hormones to bring the body back into its normal levels. Now, what is the difference between the hormonal and the nervous system is that the hormonal system releases hormones, which are chemical messengers secreted by the endocrine glands. They are secreted into the blood, travel to the target organ. The target organ has receptors, and hormones bind to the receptors and triggers a response, and it produces a slower but a long-term response. On the other hand, the nervous system uses a system of neurons which sends electrical impulses to produce a response. The message is transmitted via electrical impulses. The response produces localized, and impulses do not travel large distances, but the response is quicker but short-term. So you should know this difference between hormones and nervous, how it works, and which one is more quicker and effective. Now there's a master gland. The master gland is a pituitary. Why it is a master gland? Because it controls the other gland of the body. It controls the follicle stimulating hormone, which are responsible for management of menstruation and reproduction. Antidiuretic hormone is also controlled by the pituitary gland, which maintains the water level of the body. And thyroid stimulating hormone is also controlled by the pituitary, which maintains the metabolic levels of the body. Okay, so it's very important to know that pituitary is a master gland, and why is it a master gland. Now, to explain why is it a master gland, you should know what hormones it control and how it works. So pituitary controls the follicle stimulating hormone, which works at the ovaries and makes the female sex hormones estrogen, and that is responsible for the secondary sexual characters and the development of egg and the menstrual cycle. Thyroid stimulating hormone released by the pituitary works on the thyroid gland, stimulate the glands to release thyroxine, and the thyroxine affects liver and kidneys and controls the metabolism. And the antidiuretic hormones targets the kidney, which controls the water level by causing reabsorption of water. Adrenal gland releases adrenaline, which targets liver and heart and prepares the body for fight and flight. Testes releases the hormone testosterone, which targets the male reproductive organ and develops secondary sexual characters. Pancreas releases insulin and glucagon. The target organ is the liver, and the insulin decreases the blood glucose level, and the glucagon increases the blood glucose level. Ovaries releases estrogen and progesterone, which targets the female reproductive organs, controls the development of the egg, menstrual cycle, and develops secondary sexual characters. So these are some of the examples of the hormones with their glands, their target organs, and their effect, and you should remember them all. Okay, next we have is how the blood glucose level is maintained in the body, and this is an example of glucose homeostasis. Now, this works by the pancreas, and the pancreas releases two hormones called insulin and glucagon. Glucagon, you need to remember. Insulin lowers the blood glucose level, and glucagon increases the blood glucose level. So after meals, what happens? The blood glucose level suddenly increases. So what does pancreas do? It releases insulin. Now, insulin has these effects. It increases the permeability of the cells to take glucose so that more glucose enters the cell so that blood glucose level can go down. If the body does not require any more glucose, it converts all the excess glucose into a storage carbohydrate, which is a glycogen. It also converts the glucose into the fats and stops the breakdown of fat so that all these factors can result in decrease in glucose level. So this is how the glucose metabolism works. When the blood glucose level rises, the pancreas releases insulin. The insulin does all these factors and makes the blood level, glucose level to be normal. On the other hand, if the blood glucose level is too low, then the pancreas releases glucagon, and the glucagon does all the things opposite to insulin. So you need to remember glucagon is the hormone which increases the blood glucose level, and glycogen is the stored carbohydrate which is made in the liver, where excess glucose is converted into glycogen. Now, what happens if your body glucose level is not controlled? When the body glucose level is not controlled, it can lead to diabetes, and there are two types of diabetes, type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is insulin dependent, as in this case, the body does not produce insulin. Type 2 is insulin independent, because in this case, body do produce insulin, but your body is not responding to it. Your body becomes resistant to insulin. So in type 1, it is caused by damage to pancreas or by some autoimmune disorder or by accident, there's a damage to the pancreas. Type 2 is caused by poor lifestyle and diet. In type 1 diabetes, the person can be given insulin injections. In type 2, it is treated with lifestyle changes and a balanced diet. Type 1 is most common in young ages, where type 2 is common in obese people. Type 1 can be genetic, and type 2 is mostly environmental. In type 1, drugs might not be required. We just require insulin injections, wherein in type 2, there are some drugs are taken to make the body to respond to insulin. Okay, so you should know the differences between the type 1 and type 2. So what are the treatments for type 1 diabetes? Insulin injections. Remember, we need to take insulin injection. We cannot take insulin tablets, because insulin is a protein hormone and protein can be digested in the stomach. The insulin goes to the blood and it converts the excess glucose into the glycogen and control the blood glucose level. In type 1 diabetes, people are asked to take less carbohydrates. And if in case there are a lot of problems in managing that, pancreatic transplant, pancreatic stem cell transplant, or using stem cell to regenerate pancreatic cell are some of the future cures for maintaining type 1 diabetes. For type 2, balanced diet, regular exercise, weight management, taking drug to increase sensitivity of pancreas to insulin, or taking more insulin injections with the thought that increased concentration might increase responsiveness are the possible management techniques to maintain the type 2 diabetes. Okay, so you should know the difference between both the types of diabetes and how we control both of them. Now, this insulin maintenance, or the maintenance of water level, which we'll be seeing later, is an example of negative feedback. What is negative feedback? Negative feedback is when the level of anything rises above optimum, like the glucose concentration, the body tries to decrease it. And if the level of anything decreases below optimum, the body tries to increase it. So body is always doing negative or opposite to what has happened, and this is known as a negative feedback. For example, if the blood glucose level goes down, then the body releases glucagon that increases the blood glucose level. If the blood glucose level goes up, the body releases insulin to decreases the blood glucose level. Okay, so I hope this example of negative feedback and what is negative feedback is clear to you. Now you should know there's another hormone called adrenaline, which is a fight or a flight hormone. It is a stress hormone, emergency hormone. What effect it does to your body? It increases your heart rate, it increases your breathing rate, it increases the blood flow, it dilates the pupil, it diverts the blood flow away from the gut, and it increases the blood flow of oxygen to the brain so that you become more alert and take quicker action. Okay, so you should know the effects of adrenaline. Now, next we have to do the human reproductive system, the male reproductive and the female reproductive system. The male reproductive system,
It consists of a penis, there's a urethra, there is a bladder, there's a seminal vesicle, there's a prostate gland, and then there's a testis which produces the sperm, which is there in a scrotum. The sperms are released to these sperm ducts, and the seminal vesicles, it releases semen which mixes with the sperm, and it goes out through this urethra. And this male reproductive organ, testes, it releases a hormone called testosterone, which is responsible for secondary sexual characters. And the female reproductive system is the system of the two ovaries, and then there's a fallopian tube. The ovaries releases the egg into the fallopian tube, which travels into the uterus, and then there's a cervix and the vagina. And the female hormone is the estrogen, which is released by the ovaries, and that is responsible for the secondary sexual characters. Now, it's a very important hormonal mechanism in the body, which is a menstrual cycle, which is purely hormonal. Now, menstrual cycle is a cycle for 28 days. And in these 28 days, these are the changes that takes place in the body. So you can see this in this diagram. From day 1 to 5 is where the bleeding stage happens, which is the menstrual stage. There's a shedding of the uterus lining. And you can see all the hormones, they are at the lower level. From day 5 to day 14 is the egg maturation phase. So that is a follicular phase where egg is matured in the ovary, and the hormones responsible for the maturation and development of the egg is the follicle stimulating hormone. So you can see that the follicle stimulating hormone is started to increase in concentration. Then at day 14, the egg is released into the fallopian tube, and this egg is released, and this release of egg is caused by a hormone called luteinizing hormone. So you can see there's a sudden surge of this luteinizing hormone at the day 14. Now, after day 14 to day 18, there's a luteal phase in which there's a sudden increase in the progesterone and the estrogen hormone, which maintain. So there's an increase in progesterone and the estrogen level, because progesterone and estrogen are responsible in maintaining the uterus lining. So they maintain the uterus lining, they make it thick so that they can support the fertilized egg and cause the pregnancy. But if in between 14 and the 28 days the egg is not fertilized, then the level of the progesterone suddenly falls, and it leads us to the shedding of the uterus lining, causing menstruation, and it starts with the day 1 to day 4. Okay, so you should know what are the changes that takes place in all these days, what is the phase, and what are the hormones that are involved. So what are the hormones that are involved in menstruation? These are four hormones: follicle stimulating hormone, luteinizing hormone, estrogen, and progesterone. Follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone are released by the pituitary, and they are required in the first 14 days. Day 1 to day 14, it's the follicle stimulating hormones which causes the maturation of the eggs in the follicle and stimulates the production of estrogen, and the luteinizing hormone causes ovulation. Then the estrogen is released, stimulated by the FSH, and from day 14 to day 28, it develops a uterus lining and stimulates more LH but inhibits FSH. And the progesterone is released by the empty egg follicle in the ovaries, and it is responsible for maintaining the uterus lining from day 14 to day 28 and prepare for pregnancy. It inhibits both LH and FSH, so no menstruation happens during pregnancy. Okay, so I hope these various hormones of menstruation are clear to you. Now, to prevent fertilization, there's a contraception method, and the contraception method, they either prevents the sperm to meet with the egg, or if the sperm meets the egg, they prevent the implantation of the fertilized egg into the uterus, thus preventing the pregnancy. Now, this can be achieved by the barrier method. The barrier method includes using diaphragms or condoms to prevent the sperm to meet the egg, or the hormonal method, which prevents the egg to mature or prevents the implantation of the eggs in the uterus, or the chemical method, which uses spermicide to kill the sperms, or the intrauterine device, which prevents the embryo from planting, or surgical method, which provides permanent contraception. Okay, so these are the various contraception methods, and they can come in a long note maker or a small question. So you should know what are the various contraception methods that we have. Next we have is how contraception works. So in contraception, there are three major techniques involved: the contraceptive pill, the intrauterine devices, and the surgical method. Now, what are contraceptive pills? The contraceptive pills contains mix of female hormones, estrogen and progesterone. We call them mixed pill. They prevent the release of FSH, so thereby they prevent the maturation of egg. They also make thick mucus in the cervix, which prevents the entry of the sperm. They also prevents the uterine lining development, so they prevent the implantation. Some pills, they just contain progesterone, and at times the contraceptive implant is also inserted. So there you don't have to take the pills regularly, and this implant slowly releases progesterone and maintains the uterus lining. Or the contraceptive patch is also used, which absorbs and mixes the hormones into the blood. They have these side effects like blood pressure. They have to be taken daily, and they cause changes in the menstrual pattern. On the other hand, intrauterine devices are the mechanical devices like copper T, which is inserted into the uterus. It releases copper ions, which are toxic to the sperms. And this device also prevents the implanting of the embryo into the uterus. And some of these IUDs, intrauterine device, they also releases progesterone, which works the same way as the progesterone pills, which prevents the release of FSH, preventing the maturation of egg. They make thick mucus in the cervix to prevent the entry of sperms, and they also prevents the uterine lining development, preventing implantation. But IUDs have side effects like infections or internal bleeding. Then we have the permanent contraception, which are mostly taken by the people who already have kids. They do surgical methods, which is vasectomy, which is the male sterilization, and tubectomy, which is a female sterilization. In vasectomy, the sperm ducts are cut and sealed so that sperms cannot enter the urethra, which prevents fertilization. And in tubectomy, the oviducts are cut and tied to prevent the release of egg, which prevents the fertilization. The side effects of this is it is permanent, so you cannot resume your fertility back. But with contraceptive pills, you can stop the pills and the hormone levels can be normal. And in the intrauterine devices, you can remove the device and then the fertility is restored. Now, there are a lot of infertility problems that happens in people. The first problem is the ovulation problem, where the eggs do not mature or the eggs is not ovulating. In those cases, the women are given fertility drugs, which are mix of FSH and LH. So follicle stimulating hormones causes the development of the follicles, and luteinizing hormones stimulates the ovulation. At times, there's a tube that is faulty, so that the embryo is not able to come to the uterus, or there's an implantation problem. In that, we perform an in vitro fertilization, where embryos develop outside and it is implanted back into the uterus for the development of the pregnancy. And in the third case, even implantation happens, but pregnancy development doesn't take place. In that case, there are problems with the uterus. So the surrogate mother, where the fertilized egg is implanted into another mother who gives birth, can be a solution. Now, what is in vitro fertilization, which is very promising, and that has given babies to many of the people who do not have babies. So what do we do is we first give fertility drugs and stimulate ovulation. Then we collect the egg and the sperms, and we put it into a petri dish, and we cause the fertilization to occur. When the fertilization is occurred, we cause the zygote to divide and develop into the embryo. The embryo is then taken and inserted surgically into the uterus lining. Okay, and then this develops into a baby. So this is what is the concept of in vitro fertilization, but it has problem as it is expensive. It can result into multiple embryos, it can result into premature birth, it can result into birth with disability, and it cannot be always successful. But that has caused, it has shown a good success rate, and there are a lot of people who are opting for in vitro fertilization. Next is plant hormones. As in humans, there's a hormones controlling the body mechanism. In the same way, plant also needs some survival changes. For example, they should grow towards light, the root should go towards the gravity. So these are controlled by the plant hormones. So there are two important movements that we see in the plant is phototropism, where the shoot move towards light. You can see in this example, the shoot is moving towards light, and there's a gravitotropism, where the root moves towards the gravity. Now, why the shoot moves towards light? It is caused by auxin. When auxin is produced in the root tip and the shoot tip. So when the light falls on the auxin, you can see auxin has shifted towards the shader side. And when the auxin shift towards shader side, auxin causes the growth of the cell elongation of the shader side. As a result, cell divides onto the shader side, causing the shoot towards bent towards light. On the other hand, in response to gravity, the auxin shift towards the grounder side. So towards the lower side, the auxin develops in response to gravity. And in the roots, auxin has an opposite effect. Where it is concentrating, it is inhibiting the growth. So the other side of the root grows, which results in the bending of the root downwards. So auxin causing bending of the root downwards, and it causing the shoot to grow upwards. Why? Because in phototropism, auxin is causing the growth in the shader region. And in the gravitotropism, the auxin is inhibiting the growth onto the side where it is present. So you should know how both of these mechanisms work. Now, there are five important hormones in the plant, which are very important. Auxin, gibberellin, etine, cytokinin, and abscisic acid. Auxin stimulates cell division and is responsible for growth of the plant. It is used in the tissue culture as a rooting powder, as it causes the root to develop quickly. And it is also used as a weedicide, because when the weed, due to its broader leaf, take the auxin quickly as compared to our main crops. And these concept of thermoregulation as what changes takes place in the body when suddenly the temperature becomes too low. So when the temperature becomes too low, you must have seen the body starts to shiver. Why? Because the body detects that there is a sudden decrease in the body temperature. So the heat needs to be generated. So shivering increases the heat so that the body temperature can raise to normal. Second, the thyroid stimulates cells to increase the metabolism so that the heat production can be increased. You must have seen you get goosebumps in cold. Why? Because the body hair stands up so that they can trap the layer of insulated air, which can prevent heat loss by conduction. And you must have seen your body tends to get blue. Why? Because of the vasoconstriction. So when the temperature becomes too low, the capillaries that is supplying the blood to the surface of the skin, they constrict, they reduces the blood flow to the surface. As the blood flow to the surface is reduced, the blood can lose less heat due to radiation. On the other hand, when it gets too hot, the body hairs lies flat. There's a sweating, the sweat glands produces sweat. The sweat causes cooling of the body by evaporation. The metabolism of the body decreases, so the thyroid stimulates cells to decrease metabolism so that the less heat can be produced. And then there's a vasodilation. What is vasodilation? The capillaries that are providing the blood vessels of the capillaries that supplies the blood to the surface dilate so that more blood flows to the surface. And when more blood flows to the surface, it will lose heat by radiation. So in vasodilation, or in the hotter times, we are making more blood flows to the surface. So you should know what is the difference between vasoconstriction and vasodilation, and what changes takes place in the body in response to temperature. Okay, now let us see what are the different waste products produced in the body. Waste products are the products which are produced by the metabolic reactions like respiration and digestion. The first waste product is carbon dioxide produced during respiration. It is toxic because carbon dioxide can disturb the pH and affects the enzyme activity. So it needs to be removed immediately. So it is excreted out through the lungs. Then there are water. Then metabolism, we also produce water like in respiration or during the digestion process. It is excreted through the skin in the form of sweating or breathing, or kidneys in the form of urine. Water can also disturb the osmotic balance and salt levels. So it is very important the level of water is also maintained in the body. Now, when there's excess carbohydrates, excess fats due to digestion, that can be easily stored in the body. But protein is very harmful. The protein, excess protein, cannot be stored in the body. So the protein is digested into amino acid and the liver deaminates. That is, by the process of deamination, converts amino acid into ammonia. And ammonia is converted into urea. So urea is another waste product produced in the body by the metabolism of protein. And this ammonia is, this urea is excreted by the kidneys in the form of urine. Okay, so how these kidneys function? So we have two kidneys and these kidney receives the blood, they filters the blood and they pass the urine into via these two tubes called ureters into the bladder. The bladder stores the urine and expels the urine out through urethra. Now there are two systems that works in the excretory system, the ultrafiltration and the selective reabsorption. In ultrafiltration, the kidneys filters the blood at a very high pressure. All the waters, glucose, and useful components get also into the kidney filtrate. The blood cells and the blood proteins are too big size to be filtered. Now, once these essential things are there into the kidney filtrate, they need to be reabsorbed back into the blood. So this process is known as selective reabsorption, where the useful components are reabsorbed back into the blood. The waters are get reabsorbed at different levels depending on need of the body. Therefore, we call it a selective reabsorption. Now, let us see how the body regulates the water level. And the regulation of water level is known as osmoregulation, and it is also a negative feedback. And it involves the release of a very important hormone called an antidiuretic hormone by the pituitary. So when the water level decreases in the body, it is detected by the osmoregulatory centers in the brain, which directs the pituitary to release a very important hormone called the antidiuretic hormone, which travels into the blood and enters the kidney tubules, and it increases the reabsorption of the water into the blood by increasing the permeability of the kidney tubules. As a result, more concentrated urine is passed and it also promotes thirst so that you take in more water to resume the blood water water level. On the other hand, when the water level increases, it is also detected by the osmoregulatory centers in the brain. The release of ADH in this case is inhibited by the negative feedback. So there's less reabsorption of water, so more dilute urine is passed. So you should know how this mechanism of osmoregulation works. Now, there are people whose kidney get damaged either by an autoimmune or a genetic disorder or by some accident. So in this case, they have two solutions. First, either they take the help of the artificial kidney called the dialysis, or they do a kidney transplant. Now, what happens in a dialysis is the patient blood is taken out and it is given a heparin, which prevents the blood clotting. And then the blood is fed into a dialysis fluid, a dialysis machine, which has a dialysis fluid. The dialysis fluid contains no concentration of urea and the ideal concentration of minerals and the salt level as that of the blood. And the dialysis tubes are made up of the semi-permeable membrane. So as the blood flows into the dialysis fluid, the urea is diffused out along the concentration gradient and excess salt is also removed, maintaining the normal salt and mineral level and absorbing all the urea into the dialysis fluid. The blood now becomes pure and clean and is pumped back into the patient. Okay, so in the artificial kidney, the blood flows into the dialysis machine, which contains the dialysis fluid. It contains the same concentration of essential mineral ions as that of the blood, but no urea. So as the blood flows into the dialysis fluid, the urea is diffused out along the concentration gradient and excess salt is also removed, maintaining the normal salt and the mineral ion level, and the clean blood is then pumped back. The problem with the dialysis is that you need to regularly visit the hospital. You need to have the lifestyle changes, the changes diet, and regular expenditure are some of the disadvantages. On the other hand, there's a kidney transplant. You can see there's a damaged kidney. So from a donor, a normal kidney is transplanted, and that works normally as like of the kidney. So the donor has to be a close match because the body can reject the donor kidney because it can take that as a foreign antigen and produce antibodies and destroy it. So what do we do in this case is the person has to be given an immunosuppressant drug so that the body immune system does not reject it. But the problem is it does not last longer. And since the person is on immunosuppressant, the person can get prone to infectious diseases. Okay, so there is a trade-off. So which is the best way, dialysis versus kidney transplant? It depends on the patient condition, what he is willing and what he's not willing to do. Because dialysis has an advantages of getting no surgery, no infection, no immunosuppressant drug and easily available. But the disadvantages of lifestyle changes, regular visit, restricted diet and a long procedure. On the other hand, kidney transplant does not require any lifestyle changes, no diet restriction, no regular visit, but it does not last longer. There are chances for rejection. There are immunosuppressant drugs need to be taken. The person is more prone to infection and finding a suitable donor is a big problem. So the promising future for the kidney disorders is using stem cells, the person's own stem cells, to create the kidney cells or the nephrons so that the problem of rejection can be avoided and it can be a long-term solution. But again, the development and the research is still going on. Okay, so I hope this topic, a long topic with a lot of key terms, is crystal clear to you. Now let us see what are the key terms you should know. So you need to write about all these key terms, pause the video, write about these key terms and come back. So you should know what are homeostasis, receptors, effectors, stimulus, neurons, central nervous system, sensory neuron, motor neuron, relay neuron, reflex arc, brain, cerebral cortex, cerebellum, medulla, MRI, eye, cornea, retina, blind spot, ciliary muscle, suspensory ligaments, sclera, iris, pupil, accommodation, myopia, hyperopia, endocrine system, hormone, adrenaline, insulin, pituitary gland, FSH, LH, estrogen, progesterone, glucagon, glycogen, diabetes, menstruation, ovulation, IVF, phototropism, gravitotropism, auxin, jubilin, ethene, vasoconstriction, vasodilation, thermoregulation, dialysis, and selective reabsorption. Okay, so I hope you're able to answer these key terms. If you still are not able to answer, go back to the video, look over these terms again, and you can visit the website and check the explanation of all these. Okay, so I hope this topic is clear to you. As always, the next step, check the specification, make sure everything which is there in the specification is crystal clear to you now. And you should do exam question on this topic, which can be easily found on my website. The link is shared with you in the description box below. All these notes are there on my website. You can click on them and read them for a quick revision. If you like this video, please do subscribe to my channel and do not forget to like, comment and share this video. And also click on the bell icon, because if you click on the bell icon, you'll be notified as soon as I put a new video. And if there's any specific video you want me to put a lesson on, please leave a comment below and I'll make sure I'll have that up before your exam. In case you have any doubts in any of these concepts mentioned in this video, leave a comment below or you can come to my website where we have a 24/7 chat support till your exam to answer all your queries. Okay, so I'll see you next in my next video. Till then, happy revising.